We're so thankful to have each of you with us here at the Fowler Avenue Baptist Church, and we are trying to get the sound system all lined up, so you bear with us if you will, please. But we're here to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ. We have people visiting with us. One of our dear ladies from, I believe, New Jersey. Give us a high sign from New Jersey, back in the far back. Glad to meet her. And then some of the folks who've been away, we're so glad that you made it back to Fowler Avenue Baptist Church. Teresa Howard. Teresa, raise her right hand right here. She's been very sickly. She's going to move back to the Philippines and live with her family. So pray for her as she makes plans to go back home to the Philippines. And people going through special times right now, pray that God will give a special grace and strength. People who lost loved ones and going through different areas of trial and testing. I want to pray that God will give encouragement to each of you. We're here, as we said before, to magnify the Lord. We have a video that's being taped to go out to different people from different parts of the world and different backgrounds. And so we do a lot of repeating here, and we need to do that because some have just tuned in, but we need to get the basic about why we're here. The Bible says, this is good, except the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. There's but one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all. Again, the word ransom means a price was paid, and the price that was paid for our sin was the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses from all sin. That day he came and died on that cross and shed his blood. We beat with a cat of nine to ten, beaten very badly. There he hung, bleeding and dying between two thieves. He died. The Bible says that when he died, they put his body in the ground, but his soul went to be with the Lord. One day he's coming back. We're going to be gathered with him, absent from the body, now is present with the Lord Jesus Christ. A place called paradise, a garden of God. We're thankful for the redemption, the salvation we have in God's Son. So we're here to magnify him and uplift him today. So you that are visiting with us, and you who are members of our church, friends that have come in, you want to make sure that today is the day of your salvation. If you have doubts or questions, say that today. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died on that cross and rose again the third day. Come into my heart and save me today. That's what you need to do before it's eternally too late. As we start the service, we're going to ask Brother Gerald to come. He'll be singing, maybe leading a song. There'll be testimonies that are given. We'll have a great time today. We're glad to have you. God bless you.
Morning. This is our mission conference going on, and we got a song here on page 296. We have a story to tell to the nations. We'll sing all four verses. Please, let's stand, please.
To learn they brought.
Many years have come and gone since he walked upon our ground. They say life's short, last so long, so why's his story hanging round? And why do people stop and pray and gone? When I ask them, they just say, he's coming back to take me home. Anybody here want to live forever? Say I do. Anybody here want to walk on Golden Street? Say I do. Anybody here sick and tired of living like you do? Anybody here want a home with love forever? Say I do. And they say that you will never know into his eyes of love, and you touch the nail scars in his hand. And if you can walk away, knowing all he died to do, that's what I'll just have to say. Anybody here want to live forever? Say I do. Anybody here want to walk on Golden Street? Say I do. Anybody here sick and tired of living like you do? Anybody here want a home with love forever?
Now is the time to fight the fight. Gotta go on to prove the fight. When I first heard Jesus' name in a little church where the folks believed he came, they said they were lost until he came along. And I remember now the way they sang this song. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. And I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. But as I grew, somehow I knew I had learned the truth. Simple though it seemed to me while I was in my youth. And now I'm older and wiser, and still I know it's true today. Jesus' love can change the darkest night today. Well, every day I live my life, I know I've been set free. But when he said he loved us all, he included me. Not for anything I've done, I'm just a sinner man. But what I can't do now, I know Jesus can. And I'm leaning, safe and secure from all, oh Lord. I'm leaning on the everlasting heart.
Oh,
Oh,
come and be with us. We thank God for you parents and grandparents who bring your children to the house of God to hear the word of God. My day did not start out good today. My wife usually drives me to church, and she drives me around and so forth. And she's not feeling well today, and I said, I can drive. She said, I'll get your brother to drive. Listen, I can drive better than you. Brother, I can even drive better than you. When I'm only 85, my coordination is getting better, my eyesight's getting better, my reflexes getting better. Don't worry about it. I can make it. Amen. You understand that? So I'll open the gate, come out, and all those bushes we've been throwing out, you know, the brink, and I couldn't see. And I ran out on the road, and I hit this woman. Boom! Right in the side of her car. I said, my wife will never forgive me. So I stopped, and she stopped, and I got out of the car, and I came, and I said, are you okay? She said, yeah, I'm okay. Any damage to your car? She says, not really, nothing serious, don't worry about it. I said, okay. So we came home to church, and I'm thankful. I could have been killed, she could have been killed. But God spared us another time. But I'm so thankful for God's mercy, his grace, his long-suffering, patience to each of us. We're thankful for you being here today. We thank God for each of you who love the Lord. And you're missionary-minded, and this is our mission conference time. Pray for the missionaries, have them from different countries, India, Africa, Philippines, different Haiti, different ones. So we're thankful for a church like you that give your time, your talents, your treasure back to God, that might carry on the great work of God. So we're thankful to be here today. We praise God for his love, his mercy, his patience with us. We're going to talk on a subject today. Why did Jesus Christ come into the world? Why did he come? There's a number of verses that say Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. The Bible says because of the Adamic curse, all mankind are lost. No matter how, what your age, what color your skin, no matter where you come from, we all have the same problem. It's a sin problem. That day when God created Adam and Eve, he put them in that beautiful garden, paradise. He said, you may eat of all the trees of the garden, but don't eat of the middle of the tree, knowledge of good and evil. Eat thereof, you should surely die. Satan came along and said, you will not die. He's a liar, he's a thief, he's a murderer. Well, they partook of the fruit. The Bible says, whereas by one man Adam, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. We all have the same need. We need the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ to cleanse us from sin. So as we go into the Word of God today, one day he was asked, are you the king? He says, yes, for this purpose I was born. Jesus Christ, he came to give us the abundant life. He didn't only the eternal life, but the abundant life. He came that we might be redeemed by his blood, be saved. Our redemption, our salvation, our all is in him. It's not in the church, not in religion. I repeat this because people watching on video, they come from different backdrops, different backgrounds. And you may be religious, but if you don't have Christ as your Savior, you're religiously lost. You say, but I'm sincere. Well, sincerity will not do the job unless you have Jesus Christ as your Savior. So we pray that today you'll search your own heart. If there's a doubt about your salvation, renew your vows today. Say, Lord, today I want to know, have the assurance of my salvation. These things are written that you may know you have eternal life. This life is in his Son. If you have Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have eternal life. Never end. It's everlasting life. Today we're going to talk about the reason Jesus Christ came. Came for different reasons. Christ came to set the captive free. That's our theme. That's our subject. Christ came to set the captive free. Every one of us have been captivated. We're under the bondage and slave market of sin. It wants to rule and regulate and restrict and all of our life. We need the Lord Jesus Christ to break that chain that binds us. And so we're here to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ. In John 8, 32 through 33, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The truth shall make you one day in John chapter 8, talk about these people, says, we've never been, these Jewish people say, we've never been in bondage. We have Abraham as our father. And Jesus said, I know Abraham is your lineage of your father, but you don't have Jesus Christ. You don't have me as your Savior. You're lost. You're doomed. You're damned. You're going to hell. Nobody wants to go there. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How can you say you shall be made free? All of us need to be made free in Christ. If you're here today without Jesus Christ, you can be made free from the bondage of sin. Jesus Christ came to save us from the penalty of sin. He paid our sin debt in full. He came to save us from the power of sin that wants to rule and dominate us and control us. One day he'll save us from the very present sin. Jesus saves us from the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and one day from the very presence of sin. You need him as your personal Savior. Need him as your Savior. One of the other verses we read in John 8:36. If the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. I'm going to read Romans chapter 6, 12 through 23. Listen as I read this. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body. Isn't that interesting? We do sometimes let sin reign in our life when we get by accident and get away from God. Let not sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you. Sin shall not have dominion over you. Sin saves us from the penalty of sin, the power structure of sin, and one day from the very presence of sin. As we get into the Word of God, the Spirit of God, and the Word of God helps to overcome. That's why we need, these things have I written that you might know that you have eternal life. This life is in His Son. If you have the Son, you have eternal life. And you have the Spirit of God living within you. Your body is His temple. And you're His instrument. You're His vessel. You're His ambassador. We're His workers. Thank God for that. We come on down. It says this, verse 16. Know you not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, his servant you are, whether you obey whether unto sin unto death, or obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked, you were the servants of sin, but you've obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered to you, being then made free from sin, made free from its power structure. You became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as you have yielded yourselves servants to uncleanness, to iniquity, even now yield yourselves as servants to righteousness unto holiness. God wants us to be holy. Be ye holy, for I am holy. When you become a child of God, God becomes your Father. Christ is your Savior. The Holy Spirit of God is living within you. Your body is His temple. Verse 20. For when you were the servants of sin, you were free from righteousness. What fruit had you in those things whereof you were ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin's power, you become servants of God. You have your fruit into holiness and the end everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 8, 1 through 9. There is therefore no condemnation. No condemnation to them which are in Christ, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life of Christ Jesus made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Verse 4, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they out of spirit the things of the spirit. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it's not subject to God, neither law, neither can be. For them that For they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Being fleshly, carnal, and worldly displeases the Lord. He wants us to be spiritually and godly. Verse 8. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Once you become the child of God, Holy Spirit comes to take up his abode in your life. And you're his witness, his worshiper, his warrior, his workers. Galatians 5:1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free. Be not entangled in the yoke of bondage. Brother Pierre's message today was about being entangled. You've been made free in Christ. Yet, Satan wants you to say, no, I've got to be baptized. I've got to keep the Ten Commandments. I've got to do this. No. The only one that can save us is Jesus Christ. It's not Jesus Christ in baptism, Jesus Christ in the... It's all about Jesus. He's the one who died. He's the one who was buried, bore our sin on Calvary, third day rose again, conquering death, hell, and the grave. Hallelujah, what a Savior. O death, where's thy sting? O grave? The sting of death is sin, the strength of sin. But thanks be to God that gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our victory is in Jesus Christ, in his word, yielding to his word. Galatians 5:1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty where Christ has made us free. Be not entangled with the yoke of bondage. As free and not using your liberty as a cloak of maliciousness, but as a servants of God. So we'll give you a few other verses on this subject of being set free through Christ and his blood. Bondage verses that tell of Israel's bondage in the land of Egypt. The children of Israel were in bondage and slavery to the Egyptians, but Christ, God's Word, the Holy Spirit, came to set a house of bondage. We're going to read Exodus chapter 6, 5, 6. I have also heard of the groanings of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage. I've remembered my covenant, verse 6. Wherefore, I say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out of under the burdens of Egypt. I will rid you of their bondage, and I will redeem you with a stretched out arm and with great judgment. Exodus 13:14. And it shall be with the son of Ash, saying, what is this? Thou shalt say, by strength of hand the Lord brought us out of the Egypt from the bondage, house of bondage. Deuteronomy 6:12. Then beware lest you forget God. We forget the Lord. Beware lest you forget the Lord, which brought thee forth out of the land of bondage. He brought us out of Egypt. God set us free. He wants us to love him and serve him. We have Independence Day, July the 8th, holiday in the United States commemorating the adoption of the Declaration of Independence. Praise God for our freedom in our country. We thank God for the men and women who gave their lives, those who are serving now in our military. We thank God for every one of them. Freedom. Pays a price. Someone has to pay the price to be made free. And Jesus Christ did that when he died, shed his blood, and rose again. There are many lessons in the Old Testament about people who found themselves in the bondage of captivity, needed to experience liberty and freedom. Galatians 5:1 once again. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. Be not entangled with the yoke of bondage. We come on down to 2 Timothy. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle to all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to acknowledge the truth, they may recover themselves. They may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who have been taken captive by his will. People have been taken captive by Satan, but God, through Christ, and the Holy Spirit, the Word of God, will set us free. Give us power to be overcomers. We thank God for that. Romans 7:23. But I see another law in my member, warring against the law of my flesh, my mind, and bringing me into the captivity of the law which is in my members. We understand in Romans 6:1-23 the danger of sin. Sin wants to reign, rule, rob, and ruin every Christian. That's what sin will do. And God wants us to be set free, liberty and freedom, to do His work and do His will. Christ has freed us from the penalty, the power of sin, the penalty of sin, and one day from the very presence of sin. We thank God for the freedom that we have in Jesus. We thank God that we've been set free by the blood of Jesus Christ. If you're here today, you never asked Christ to be your Savior. If you're doubting your salvation, saying, well, I'm not sure, why not today do as we ask these people to do right here watching on video, coming from different backgrounds, different backdrops. You got to say this: Lord Jesus, I believe that you're the Son of God. I believe you died on that cross and shed your blood. I believe on the third day you rose again, conquering death and the grave. Say this: Lord Jesus, I'm not trusting religion. I'm not trusting water baptism. I'm trusting Jesus. He's the one that did all the work. He bore our sins on Calvary. He bled and died and rose again, conquering death, hell, and the grave. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me today. Pray that prayer, dear friend. I know you may be religious, you may be sincere, but you need the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to go back to a time and a place where you know that you know. You said, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me. October the 4th, 1956, during a revival meeting, I came forward. I told my pastor, teach a class of boys, junior boys. He said, what are you doing here? Are you singing in the choir? Are you teaching? He says, Bab. I said, Bab Adams, I'm not trusting the preacher. I'm not trusting the church or the religion. I'm trusting Jesus. I'm coming to drive that stake down in my life. That day I came forward, I'm not sure. I might have gotten saved, I don't know. But today I know, I'm saying to you and to the world listening, I'm trusting Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. He's the one who died, who shed His blood, and rose again the third day. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. You need to examine yourself. The Bible says, examine yourself to see if you be in the faith. You say, I'm religious. That won't do it. I'm a Baptist. I believe there will be some Baptists in heaven. I believe there will be some. You know what Baptists will be in heaven? Saved Baptists. I believe there'll be some Pentecostals in heaven. I believe there'll be some Catholics in heaven. I believe that it'll be in heaven those who've come and said, Jesus, I'm not trusting religion. I'm trusting you. You're the one that died. You shed your blood. You rose again that third day. And you're the one I'm trusting as my Savior. Go down memory lane to the time and the place. You know that you know. You know the place. You know the time. You said, Jesus, I'm trusting you as my personal Savior. Right now, we again repeat to these people here, ask the Lord Jesus Christ to be your Savior. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died for me and rose again. Come into my heart and save me. Father, we pray those that have done that today, find a good Bible-believing church. Give them the Word of God that may grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for this time together. Help us to go forth, being that example you'd have us to be, being that witness you'd have us to be, being that ambassador you'd have us to be. Help us, Lord, is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.